Hi, Kate, can you hear me?
And this is the International Space Station. How do you hear me?
Hi, I can hear you. This is Simon.
It is great to talk to you. Sorry about the audio configuration issues. That's kind of what happens when you're in space sometimes.
Is that you, Kate?
It is. I'm calling you from the U.S. Laboratory on the International Space Station.
That is fantastic. I have never spoken to anybody in space before. Not when they've replied, anyway.
Well, this is a lot of fun, and I just want to start out by saying that I got a chance to watch your movie, and I think probably I had the best view because I watched it from our cupola, which is our windows that are facing the Earth. You can still see a lot of the galaxy as well. I got some good advice from other astronauts that it's great to kind of curl up there and get your whole body inside the cupola, and brought my iPad in, and that's where I camped out for a couple hours watching your movie. So that was, I got a little distracted by Earth a few times.
That is incredible. I can't think of a more conducive environment to watch a science fiction film than from space. That's utterly amazing. I'm jealous.
It was pretty perfect. And I have to say, a lot of folks have asked me what your thoughts on space were, or how did it compare before you flew. And the best way, actually, that I can think to describe it is your special effects guys get it right. There's something about a small craft orbiting a large planet. When I see that movie screen, it absolutely feels like Space Station.
Oh, that's marvelous. They'll be so happy. I'll make sure I let them know. I guess they do their research, you know, when they're visualizing the VFX in the movie. You know, they have to look at real footage, I guess. So they're probably looking at stuff like the ISS.
Well, it's perfect. I wanted to let you get a chance to ask any questions you have about space and what it's like to be on the space station.
Yeah, I mean, firstly, when you have a movie night like that, when you watch a film, do you sit down or do you just sort of float and watch it as you drift?
Yeah, there's no sitting up here, so we're floating all the time. It looks kind of like I'm standing here, but I'm actually floating. And so when you're kind of sitting there for a while and you're watching something, you don't really want to hold on to something, so you tuck in and then you can hook your feet under something, and that actually is a very comfortable position. That's our equivalent of sitting.
How long does it take you to adjust to that sort of state of being? Because it must be very disorienting at first. I guess in training you do it, but when you're up there.
Yeah, it's really hard to train for weightlessness. We can do some of it underwater or in the zero-G aircraft. The hardest thing is to understand the concept that there's no up anymore. That takes about 3 weeks to get used to. And it's also pretty hard when you first get here to be able to move yourself around. We now move ourselves around with our feet. I actually will use my hands to do a task, but I stabilize with my feet all the time, and just learning how to control yourself and move yourself in all six axes at the same time, yet stay stable enough to do your task. It takes a good month before you get good at that.
And do you tune into it, the notion of, you know, that there is no up? Do you sort of, does that come into focus, and then it's very natural that there is no up for you?
Yeah, absolutely. At the beginning, you really want to be heads up all the time, and then after a while, that goes away because you can work on the walls or the ceilings here. So you start to work on the walls and the ceilings. And I actually have been having trouble recently. Mission Control keeps asking me to point the camera at the exercise equipment with the top of the equipment up, and I cannot get it right. They're constantly having to vector me like, oh, no, 90 degrees clockwise, 180 the other way, because I'm not sure. It's coming out of the wall, and it doesn't all make sense to me that you would have an up and a down on this.
So do you expect to have some sort of disorientation when you come back to Earth and you know, suddenly there is an up and a down again?
Yeah, there's some neurovestibular effects. Those actually go away within a few days. And I think it's a little bit easier on the return trip coming back to the planet because you're stuck there with this gravity vector. I mean, everybody's sort of stuck down on the planet and your head's forced to face a certain direction. So it kind of puts you in the right orientation.
Yeah, I guess it's like your sea legs, but, you know, times 1,000, having to sort of readjust. I was wondering about, you know, obviously the big thing that you always see in science fiction movies is artificial gravity. And I wondered what the kind of thoughts about that were, the possibility of creating it, whether we're close to it or it's a complete impossibility, or, you know, you're as good a person to ask as any.
Yeah, in order to create that, we need to spin things. And so we can do that on a micro level here. Actually, just right before I was talking to you, I had a drill out, and I was centrifuging some samples for a molecular biology experiment. So you can do that on the micro level. In terms of actually creating artificial gravity on the human level, you need a module big enough, and you need to be able to spin it. Was in original space station plans, but that's not really in our design plans right now. And one of the things that is the most interesting about space station is actually the fact that we have microgravity here. I mean, it's really, people say weightlessness, it's much reduced gravity. That actually allows us to do a lot of our experiments. So I think for a while, at least, we're going to keep the astronauts floating up here and see what happens to humans and to cells in microgravity.
Yeah, I guess it's a completely, literally alien environment. So you don't have that opportunity anywhere else. And certainly not on the Earth, but yeah, why make it like Earth, I guess. One thing I do want to ask is, what do you do anything fun with the zero G? Do you do like, because you know you sometimes see the water things, you know, like bubbles of water, and do you have little moments of recreational gravity fun, gravity-free fun?
Absolutely. Sometimes I try to do them on camera before PAO events for Houston. But just pulling a bubble of water out of the drink bag and moving it around on your hand, a little droplet of water will stick to your hand. It moves along the surface of your hand. And actually, if you think about it too much, it looks a little bit creepy. It's kind of horror movie. So if you're wringing out a lot of water, it'll completely move up your hand and just envelop your hand because it's sticking to the surfaces. So I've been playing with small amounts of water. And one weekend a while back, my crewmates and I invented a game that was played on the walls and the ceiling with a ball. I'm not sure, it's a cross between football and Quidditch, and we made up some rules.
I love it that you've invented a new sport that only you can play. Now, you studied molecular biology, right, in your educational years?
Yeah, that's correct.
So because I remember when I was at school, like when I was five, they asked me what I wanted to be when I grew up. And I remember writing a little story and drawing an astronaut and sort of saying this. But your career path must have kind of, when did you decide, oh, I'm going to do this in space?
Well, my little kid list was astronaut, biologist, and geologist. And nobody ever really successfully talked me out of the fact that I can't be all three at once. So I haven't formally studied geology, but we do. I've gotten really interested in observing our Earth, and I get a chance to take about 1,000 pictures a day up here. So you can see geology on a massive scale. Anytime you get a chance to look at the planet, it's incredibly beautiful.
Wow, way to underachieve, Kate. You could only manage the molecular biology and the astronaut thing, and you're doing the geology on an amateur level. I mean, come on. I think...
Because I'm just too stubborn to say no.
Yeah. I think I wanted to be an astronaut. I ended up being a pretend one, whereas you ended up being a real one. Looking at Earth, I often read about people who've been into space and how the sight of our planet from space is a very profound moment. And I wondered, what are your feelings about that?
Yeah, absolutely. The first glimpse of our planet I caught actually was in our Soyuz spacecraft, which is much smaller than the space station. That is a tiny little, cram three people in there. It's about the size of the trunk of your car. So just even getting a chance to put my face up to the window, this was a couple orbits after launch, and see the planet for the first time was absolutely incredible. And of course, on the space station, we have the cupola and we have these windows where you can really get your whole head and your whole body in there and just see the planet. I think the most amazing experience was on a spacewalk, getting a chance to take a look at the planet with nothing but you and your spacesuit visor between you and this. It's glowing. It's really bright and glowing. It's beautiful. Yeah.
And do you feel it kind of gave you a new perspective on reality? You know, just the knowledge that is everything that we are is contained in that one sphere?
Absolutely. And it sounds really cliche, but when you're looking down at a continent, you can't see borders. I can't see states in the United States. I can't see borders between countries. I actually sometimes we're going over things and you start to recognize things more by their landmass, their physical characteristics, what seas or oceans are near them, and really stop thinking so much about countries, because one second I'm over Australia, then I'm over Turkmenistan, then I'm coming up off the coast of Patagonia. And so we go so quickly, we see so many different places in the world. It starts to feel like home everywhere. I recognize these land masses everywhere.
I often think that, you know, in terms of when you're thinking about the kind of the more outlandish science fiction ideas, is that it seems the only time in fantasy that the Earth becomes one and realizes that is when we are attacked by an alien race. You know, it's a shame that it would have to take something that cataclysmic for us all to have that understanding that we are just all the same on this one little ball in outer space.
Well, I think the other thing is, if we send more people to space, you get that perspective in a peaceful way. One of the first thoughts that I had, that I constantly have, is we live on a planet. And that sounds, obviously, we live on a planet, but that means something very different. I see it every day that we actually do live on a planet, and it's traveling through outer space. You can see that in a little bit different way from up here.
Yeah, I bet. Were you able to see Hurricane Matthew from your, I presume you were, from your vantage point?
Yeah, absolutely. And one of the things we were able to do is take a lot of photographs of Matthew. And that number one is for the science. It really helps the weather forecasters and the hurricane folks study this hurricane, understand how they form and work on prediction models in the future. The other thing that we're able to do through the International Disaster Charter is actually take photos in the aftermath. From the space station, we have some unique vantage points where we can actually zoom in and get photos of flooding, helps the relief workers, and helps folks in the recovery effort.
Wow, that's incredible. And I heard that it's a myth that you can see the Great Wall of China from where you are.
Yeah, I haven't actually tried. There are some amazing things that you can see from space. You can see with a long telephoto lens, you can see the pyramids. You can actually see our launch site in Baikonur, Kazakhstan. So one of my crewmates has the top 100 places in the world up on a map constantly, and we're always looking and trying to pick out different places.
And you orbit the Earth 16 times a day, is that right?
Yeah, that's correct. We're going 17,500 miles an hour.
Wow. Are you ever aware when you're passing over home? Do you ever get a little kind of a temptation to get up in the cupola and just wave?
I wave to them. It's actually pretty fun to see all the different places you've lived and take a look at the cities and get a chance to wave at folks when you're going over.
Do you feel disconnected from Earth in any way? I mean, do you keep up with the news? Obviously, I'm sure you do, but it must be quite a strange thing to watch news broadcasts knowing that you're not on that rock.
I actually have found it marvelously pleasant, and
I'm sure you are. It's probably best up there, to be honest, at the moment.
Yeah, I've pretty much asked to not have too much news up here. Sometimes it's pretty nice to be off the planet.
Yeah, I think a lot of people feel the same way. I also wondered, just in terms of your daily routine, when you wake up in the morning, do you immediately know where you are? Or do you have that sometimes? I mean, I'm sure you do now because you've been up there since July. But I go on tour a lot doing press tours and stuff. And sometimes I'll wake up in a hotel somewhere and I don't know where I am. I walk into the wall because I think I'm at home. When you wake up in the morning early on in your stay up there, does it take a while to sink? Go, oh, yeah, I'm in space.
You do immediately know where you are because you're floating. So you wake up, and the first thing, you're always aware that you are not on Earth because you happen to, in your sleeping bag, and you're floating. I did have the very first day that I docked. We came out of our Soyuz, and I was seeing Space Station for the first time, and it's huge. And I took a right and flew down to the Russian segment. I hadn't seen the U.S. segment and where my sleeping quarters were going to be and all of that. That was left. And my commander and one of my crewmates were fit to be tied. I mean, they were laughing so hard in the corner. Didn't say anything, just gestured to me, hey, you're going the wrong direction.
That's amazing. That's, I can't even begin to imagine what it must be like, you know, just day to day. But I guess, you know, as human beings, we adapt very quickly, and it must feel pretty normal to you now.
It does. It does start to feel very normal to float. I'm starting to think about how odd it's going to be back on the planet. But there are things, even on a daily basis, just sitting in the cupola the other day, I realized I could see the moon, the planet, and the sun. And somehow that combination of four orbital bodies at once, because we're orbiting as well, I could actually see planetary motion, and I had to stop and think about that one for a good 20 minutes. You can see that on the Earth, the Milky Way, so, you know, if you're in a place without light pollution, it just goes over you. But here, it's on your left and your right from the cupola. So there's something about that. You feel like you're in a spiral galaxy in a way that I haven't understood before. So there's something on, just on a daily basis that makes me gasp out loud usually.
I bet it must be awesome in the truest sense of the word. How many people are up there with you?
I've got two crewmates. My Japanese crewmate, Priya Onishi, and Anatoly Ivanishin is our Russian commander. And we've been on the space station for a few months now, all together. And we're going to welcome three new crewmates launching from Kazakhstan in a couple weeks here.
Is that fun when new people arrive? Do you try and make friends with them real quick?
Absolutely. We're already, we've trained together for years, so we know these guys really well. We're really excited about welcoming new folks, new crew on board, showing them around our beautiful vessel and how, what life on station is like.
Oh, man, I'm so jealous when you say that. My beautiful vessel, that just makes me want to get in a rocket. I wish it was that easy. It's not. So that must be a changing of hands, right? Because you're coming home the end of this month, I think.
Yeah, that's correct. We'll have a change of command ceremony. We even we have a ship's bell located just up in that corner. And so there's a lot of Navy traditions up here. We will hand over the space station to the new crew. And then in November, so there'll be three for a little while like we've been. And then in November, there'll be three more launching. And they'll be back up to six again.
Do you have the bosun's whistle like they do in Star Trek? That.
No, but somebody should fly one. That is a great idea.
I know. It's amazing, actually, with, I mean, Star Trek's been around for 50 years. It's amazing how that has influenced technology in some ways, you know, just even down to just the flip phone, and various technological breakthroughs have been inspired by things in Star Trek, which is a kind of nice little symbiosis, I think.
Absolutely. And I say all the time as we're moving with genomic medicine and point-of-care diagnostics, I really would like a tricorder. That would be great to have up on board.
It would also be great to have a tablet which makes you grow a new kidney and all the other things they have. Kate, I was wondering as well, just in terms of, you know, without getting too personal, family and stuff at home, how often do you get to speak to them, and do you get to send sort of private messages?
Yeah, so we get a chance to do a video chat once a week with family, and we can set up calls more often if we're going to do voice only. So we actually are pretty connected to the planet. I worked for some time in the Democratic Republic of Congo, and that was actually harder to talk to my husband from there than it has been from space.
Yeah, you were doing some work with diseases, right? With that sounds so layman, but yeah, you were studying was it Ebola and Lassa over there?
Yeah, that's correct. Monkeypox, Ebola, and Lassa. And it's actually pretty striking how similar space station is. You would think that that would not be coincident at all with a remote medical environment, but we have the same kind of challenges up here, operating on solar power only. That's how you get your power in space. Trying to deal with communications through satellites is not always easy. How we would launch samples out to our work site. So actually, it's been pretty nice to be on the space station and see what kinds of logistics challenges up here mirror what we see in remote environments on Earth.
Of course. I mean, how nervous were you when you did your first spacewalk?
I wouldn't say I was nervous. Part of our job is completely train the fear out of astronauts. Fear is not a useful, or nerves are not a particularly useful operational response. We do have thousands of hours of training on the ground in the neutral buoyancy laboratory, the giant pool. We train on all of the hardware and all the tasks. There is that moment when you open the hatch and you float out for the first time. And I found that the hat, you know, my commander opened the hatch. He went out first. I got a glimpse of the Earth through the hatch, and I had to wait some time. There was some work that he was doing hooking up the tethers. I couldn't wait to get out. I had to like almost hold on inside because I was so excited to get out that hatch. It was such an amazing and incredible experience.
And you're tethered to the space station, but do you have sort of something which, like a rocket pack or something, which gets you around? How do you move around the space station on the outside?
Yes, in answer to your question, we do have a jet pack. That's fun to say. And we use that in case of emergency only. So for the most part, we are tethered and we use our hands. We call it translating, and that's how we move ourselves around. We actually were incredibly lucky. We got a chance to go all the way to the forward part of the space station. So we were sitting a little bit like at the very front of a ship. The ship happened to be going through space at 17,000 miles an hour, and you're watching the planet below you, and we ended up installing some hardware on that very forward part of space station. That was neat. On the second spacewalk, we got to go way out to the very end of the truss segment, and we were in between the solar arrays. So that was also another incredible place to be flying on space station.
Do you get any sense of movement? I mean, you're traveling so fast, but obviously the distances between things, the relativity for you must be hard to determine that you're going that fast. But do you get any sense of it at all?
You can fly along the Earth. So when I sit in the cupola, if I don't have any view of structure around me, you really feel like you're flying. And you're going so fast that your normal scale doesn't quite catch up. I was taking some photographs of Vancouver and Seattle. I'm really confused as to why there were some really big lakes right next to Seattle. I didn't understand what I was looking at, and it turned out that was the Great Lakes and that was Michigan, and the fact that you can see, Vancouver and Michigan or all of Europe or, you know, all of Southeast Asia at the same time,
yeah.
One view, it takes a little while to get used to that.
That's crazy. We actually filmed Star Trek Beyond in Vancouver, and the planet Altamid that we all crash on was... the forests between sort of Whistler and Vancouver. So looking down, you were seeing the surface of an alien planet in a way, not really.
That's wonderful. That must have been amazing to film there. It's one of the most beautiful places, and I love taking pictures of it.
I love British Columbia. It's always it's a beautiful thing to look at from the ground. Goodness knows what it must be like from space. Are you do you Instagram up there? Do you do that kind of thing?
So I send any of my social media through the NASA astronauts account, and I take photos, and the ones that are so beautiful, I feel I have to share this with the planet. I do send down, and they tweet that out through the NASA astronauts account. That goes to, I think, all the Facebook and Instagram pages as well.
I'll have to follow that. It must be great to have – are you taking them on a camera, or are you doing it on your phone? I'd love it. Please tell me it's just your phone.
No, we actually have some really fantastic cameras up here, 800-millimeter lenses. We have some really great camera for cinematography. We just are astronauts and are not particularly good at taking video. It's a little wobbly. The professionals would be disgraced by this, but we do get pretty good at photography, so we love taking pictures. You know, we take thousands of pictures a day, and NASA actually makes all of that publicly available, so we kind of tweet out the best ones, but people can see that. That all goes into the public domain right away.
I can imagine, you know, sometimes in the evening when there's a nice sunset and people just snap it, but you are seeing that, you know, every hour of the day, there's probably a wonderful photograph out the window. It must be sort of tempting to just spend the entire day looking out of the window.
Yeah, Houston, I think, would get a little bit upset if I did that, though. They keep us on task pretty well. We have a lot of work to do.
Have you, at any point when there's been a little glitch or something, I'm sure there never is, but have you been tempted to say, Houston, we have a problem?
I did when I didn't have audio comm for one of my conferences. I did write that on a piece of paper and hold it up to the camera just for fun.
How could you not? It would be a shame if you didn't. All right, Kate. Well, I guess I should let you get on with your work. You must be incredibly busy, and I feel like I'm just holding you up with idle chatter.
Absolutely not. It is wonderful to talk to you. It's really, really neat to get a chance to see what you guys envision alien worlds and the future to be. Sometimes I feel a little bit like I'm living in the future up here, and so I love the art and life imitating each other. And thank you very much for calling the space station. It was really wonderful to talk to you today.
Not at all. And if you need a chief engineer to come and fix your warp core, you know where I am.
We absolutely will give you a call.
Thank you, Kate. It's lovely, lovely to talk to you.
Talk to you too.